Dear customer, to avoid this connection, link your national identification number. Thank you.
As the world continues to be driven by technology, it has become increasingly important for governments to transition fully into the digital process of service delivery. In the light of this, there has been more and more investments in digital technology systems, DTSs. However, with the continuous investment and procurement of DTSs, it has become crucial to assess the role these technologies drive Nigeria's economy. Between July and August 2021, the Public and Private Development Center, with support from the Africa Freedom of Information Center, AFIC, conducted a study to understand the government's procurement of digital technology systems, such as artificial intelligence, facial recognition, and digital identity, as well as how it affects citizens' rights.
In the course of doing this, we try using the Freedom of Information Act, right, to request for information regarding procurements done by different agencies, including the security sector. And we've been doing this for over 10 years. There's usually no response, especially from the security agencies, about what kinds of procurements that they make. And I understand it's confidential, it's sensitive information and all that. But then there's
would the procurement of those things be confidential information?
Well, at some point.
Because
would
in
be,
other clients,
right,
I can look up now and find out, okay, how many digital stuff was bought,
right,
let's say for LAPD,
right,
for example.
Right.
An American citizen can have that.
Can get it.
So why is it difficult in Nigeria?
The process of procurement of DTS in Nigeria is not open for reasons best known to government. I would say it's not fair. Citizens would, you know, tax money is being used for certain things, are supposed to know at least what their money is spent on and how much at least is being spent on such things in the country.
What you see mostly is a one-line item saying we are buying this is Igu High, something. I mean, it's all in the job. Just go and check NSA budget, check Department of State Services budget. They always just put it in one liner without details about what is being procured. So the procurement process has kind of been hidden. It's not open, it's not fair, and it's not transparent.
You know, you've talked about procurement processes, and you will not expect me to give you my plan to deal with terrorists or to deal with bandits. Yes, while I agree with the fact that I'm not a procurement expert, neither am I a digital technology system expert, but I think, yes, as a country, we need to do a lot, but yet we need to be careful.
What does it really say of our procurement process around that DTS?
Data is now in, like, warfare. Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. If a country owns your data, it's more or less like honing you.
Okay.
So when you buy from a company in Israel or another one in Turkey or Russia, what you're doing essentially is you're giving everything away to that country.
It can be a cause of concern that foreign entities are being patronized for data mining process exercises in Nigeria, which means that those foreign entities have access to those data, which you cannot really subpoena over how they use it or whether they choose to use it. Also, there is cyber security risk. There is identity fraud risk. It just makes the process vulnerable to a lot of things because it has been reduced to profit-making objective, and even the corruption that kind of surrounds the process makes it difficult. So the reliability of data collected is also, you know, under question because you have shortchanged the system, you have shortchanged the process, and now it's anything you see, you get.
What's even more scary in terms of what citizens don't know is where government is buying these things from. Are they buying it from, you know, authoritarian governments globally? I mean, countries that we already know on their own are infringing on the rights of their own citizens, and you don't expect that governments of another country would, of course, promote itself as a democratic nation, should be buying such systems from such countries.
Do you know that as I speak to you, SAGEM still has a database of Nigerians that it has refused to hand over to the Nigerian government because of contractual disagreement? So from documented evidence that we have seen, it appears as though the process wasn't followed. So it's not even about transparency of the process now, it's about creating, putting the process in place but not following the process you have put in place. As a matter of fact, this led to indictment of 3 federal ministers at the time.
SACU is selling monitoring systems globally and has sold to Nigerian government more than once. We wouldn't know here. Because it's not in any procurement portal. It is not in Nigerian budget. So when I said there's a budget of Nigeria that tells us how all the money is spent, right? And they will have the open treasury portal too. There's none of them that tells us how money went from somebody to buy ordinary drones.
Our own argument now is, at what time does a particular procurement lose its sensitivity, right? Mm-hmm. So if you procure something, say, in 2002, you can't still say it's sensitive or confidential in 2021. Nobody can actually evaluate, okay, these things, we've bought it, say, 20 times. It hasn't worked. Can we do something else? Right? But since we don't have that information, we can't even make that kind of comparison.
If you go back to 2014, when Nigeria spent, it was about $40 million buying surveillance equipment from Elbit, the company in Israel, it's leaked, right? And it was after that, the National Assembly then retroactively created that law. You know, allowing for surveillance, interception, and all of those types of things. So I guess all of these come back to how does a government see its people? What does it consider to be its responsibility towards those people? Because if you know that you owe me this information, then you'll put it out. There have been several investigative cases, I think Premium Times published one a few years ago, where they were trying to get information on some equipment, some military equipment Nigeria bought. Nigeria said it was, you know, national security matter. So they went on the website of the Americans and the information was there. It's weird.
Even the one that we got reported, we're going to buy, we're going to take from our SS Code account to buy certain, you know, vehicles, armored vehicles. We still don't have that information on open contracting data, right? The WhatsApp and Turaya that we saw by Locke in the supplementary budget, there is no rational justification, which is the planning document on the COPO.
Are there available data on DTS procurement? Can we go somewhere and say, this is it from 19 what to XYZ, this is what was gotten, this is from where, this is how much, you know, do we have available data?
Yeah, I would say yes, not only DTS. So we have a portal, Nigeria Open Contracting Portal.
Okay.
It's a portal where procurement plans and records are being published. So before, you know, based on the provision, in line with the provision of the Procurement Act, you should not award a contract without making a plan, procurement plan for it. And then after planning, after execution, you come back to the same portal and publish, you know, information on that particular contract. You know, how much is it awarded, who is the contractor, what is the project location, and all of that. So we have that portal, and we have, you know, section, we have provision for, you know, civil society organization, private sector, and even ordinary citizens to go to the portal and search for those records. So the portal is there. I'm not limiting it to only, you know, DTS, you know, all other procurements, even the defense procurement that doesn't pertain to national security is there. The Ministry of Education, all types of procurement, go to that portal, you have that information. Yeah, so I'm not
citizens
limiting
citizens have only access to it?
Pardon?
Citizens.
Citizens, yeah.
Have access
citizens
to
can
it.
Search.
Okay.
There's a provision for, you know, search, for the public search for citizens.
Is that your short answer something?
It's my brother, it's my partner. We work together, I mean, to support.
Yes.
We partner as civil society with BPP. So I like the fact that it's providing us the general template and that helps us to cover the real action, right?
Okay.
If you search on Okopo today, I don't know if you see any procurement information about a digital surveillance or monitoring system. So yes, there are a lot of information on Okopo. I access it. I've used Okopo to write stories, to investigate, but I've not seen anything on DTS.
If you can't find any information on a particular defense procurement, it is because the Procurement Act is very clear on it. So let me clarify this.
Okay.
Now, secondly, I must tell you the truth that, first of all, the portal is new. It was something that we established in 2018. It's a new portal. That is 2 years, about 3 years now. And then we have challenge of, you know, compliance, making the MDS to comply. So it's not as if you cannot find a particular data on the portal, it doesn't mean that the data doesn't necessarily exist. Because we are still, you know, in the process of getting the MDS to actually upload information on the data.
So we're trying to ensure that there is some part of procurement that even if they're relating to a little bit of security, we can find a way of ensuring that those procurements are imputed on the system. But when you talk about detailed munitions and drilling down to those, we're coming up with a policy on defense procurement, of which we're working with the defense sector from the Chief of Defense Staff and all that, of which we're going to come up with different strategies and ensure how we can try to make everything a little bit more open than it is now.
I'm not sure we have any, like we said earlier, any regulation or any policy in place, essentially. And so it would be that level of, you know, regulation or, you know, executive, you know, policy is put in place such that what is to be, you know, procured or purchased, who is procuring or purchasing, the purpose, the rationale, and the onward utilization is known.
That Nigeria also needs to conform to global-based standards in terms of pursuing or purchasing technology, especially intrusive technologies like surveillance technology, or even technology that is being used, for example, to mine citizens' data, like all this name capturing that we are doing and all of that. And so there has to be some, you know, global-based practices around how, not just how those technologies are acquired, but also how they are implemented, how they are used, to be ensured that, so that we can ensure that they are not used outside the purposes for which they were bought.
Government needs to subscribe more to the Shwani principle, needs to, you know, obey its own freedom of information, you know, law, which expects that when people request for information that you probably didn't proactively make open, that is also provided.
As the use of digital technology in various sectors of the economy continues to grow, one of the legal issues that arise is how these technologies impact citizens' privacy. According to statistics by the International Telecommunications Union, internet penetration in Nigeria is 27%. The percentage of households with internet access is 17%. Fixed broadband subscription is 0.04%, and active mobile subscription is 19.9%. Several laws have been enacted in order to protect the rights of citizens online. Laws such as the Digital Rights and Freedom Bill of 2016, which seeks to guarantee the fundamental privacy rights of citizens and define the legal framework regarding surveillance, promote the freedoms of expression, assembly, and association online, outline the provisions of lawful and authorized interception of communication within the digital environment without sacrificing the freedom and constitutional rights of citizens, guarantee the application of human rights within the digital environment, provide sufficient safeguards against abuse online, and provide opportunity for redress, and equip the judiciary with the necessary legal framework to protect human rights online.
To what extent has this particular bill been implemented in Nigeria? And it's a requirement now. I mean, the NIN thing is ongoing, everybody, and then we're linking it to our
SIM cards,
everyone's trying to link it to your international passports. I understand, and it's a good idea that we're trying to have a central database for Nigerians, which is great, long overdue, but very great. But then the question now is, those data, how safe are our data?
Give me the answer.
We don't have any legislation in Nigeria that protects the data of citizens. So I remember I volunteered with Paradigm Initiative way back in 2014, and we drafted the first Nigeria's Digital Rights and Privacy Bill. It went to Mr. President in 2018. He declined assent. A revised version of that bill has now been within the National Assembly since 2019, and it's just been lingering, you know, dangling from table to table.
Every other day, we've seen journalists being arrested just by trailing their conversations on their phones. We've seen how also the data that has been collected by telecommunication companies have been, government have used their power arbitrarily now, you know, to retrieve such information. We've seen where through BVN also, I mean, government has requested a bank close down, accounts of organizations that are, you know, voice of dissent in the country. So you can imagine that level of, you know, lack of protection that already exists.
How come an individual knows my BVN number? How come somebody can even get my PIN, my ATM that is with me, I mean the card? How come somebody knows it? So how am I sure that my digit is also protected.
Nobody's supposed to access to my data. It's my privacy, it's my private document. Nobody has right to it. But you find out that some people's data, people trace it, get inside it, dupe them. Why? If government is protecting it, nobody will dupe you. You understand? So it's, the government is not doing it. It's not doing enough.
Most of the bank managers are 419 now. Yes, now, because sometimes you just receive message, they'll debit you, and you do withdraw money, they'll just debit you from your account, and you don't know how come you didn't withdraw money.
For the elderly ones, they are often scammed, you know, because they don't get to know these things on time. And when they get to know it, via their children, and then by that time, it's too late already.
And how can we trust the integrity of the people with whom those pieces of information will be housed if there's no law keeping them in check? I mean, and we've already had the conversation in Nigeria recently about our Minister for Digital Economy and some of the utterances he's made in the past and how those utterances could be inimical to the security of the country. So how do we want to entrust the data of over 200 million people into the hands of a government ministry without any laws backing it? Let's not even talk about the fact that these laws are never kept and justice is slow, but now there's nothing. If you go back to January, when there were deadlines for NIN registration, even in the midst of a pandemic, in a Nigeria that was still waiting for vaccines to be donated to us, you're getting people to throng at different locations to register their NIN. What was the urgency? And if you look at that, which is why I said we're reactionary, and you know, it almost looks silly because that deadline has now been postponed 7 times. So what was the rush in January? So, no. We don't have any frameworks that protect this data. We don't have frameworks that protect what can be collected. We don't have frameworks that protect what the data will be used for, where it will be housed, what my recourse to justice or redress is if there is a breach.
Sometimes we see some people why never even go to their shop
before they will send you
message. They never ask. How many?
Exactly.
So me, I want to say maybe now the service provider just share your number.
I'm not supposed to share them. They're not supposed to share those your information without your permission. So now you're supposed to give them permission before they share them. Almost even me too, they get those kind of messages. Ah. So now we've come part of this while doing the research, many Nigerians understand what it need be. Say, those things they sell them, and they're not supposed to share your information.
Oh, wow.
So to what extent those information, where they key in, all those things, how well is it protected?
The NIMC Act says that Nigerian data can actually, you know, for reasons best known to NIMC, be given out to third party. It's in the act. So we are sitting on gunpowder, and when it comes to who monitors our phone, today you can search on your phone, right? You will buy all the INEC data, 200,000 Nigeria, entire country.
And we must be very honest with ourselves about the shrinking civic space. If you look at the new regulations for broadcast, for broadcasters, if you look at the new regulations for print, if you look at, you know, the attacks on our civil liberties and our voices, you have to be very wary of the fact that even though we have NIN, we have NIMC, we have all of these types of things, NITDA, or is it NCC, has recently put out, well, not recently, a couple months ago, put out something that they want to have IMEI numbers. So essentially, you want to be able to tell the location of a phone, not just the information that's being passed through that device. You want to be able to tell Chioma is inside the Hilton, she's in Kano room. What do you need that information for?
I think citizens in Nigeria know that they need to provide this data to government to be able to get a document that can be used against them if they don't have it, such as driver license, you know, you don't have a NIN, a BVN, that means you can't transact and you can't make calls, for instance.
So there's always an announced reason or like a publicly, you know, or a publicized reason for using data or for collecting data. So for example, talk about NIN, you hear things like, oh, Nigeria needs to know its citizens. And one of the ways you can know it is to digitally, you know, register our citizens so that you know that, oh, this person is who he says he is. But what is often not told or what is often not communicated is the fact that when those data are collected, they are used for other purposes. They are used for surveillance, they are used for even for commercial purposes. There are people who use it to provide what I call EKYC services, like maybe you want to work in an organization. The organization can use those data that you have given to a NIMC, for example, to verify who you are, who your identity is, and all of that, and get more information about you. So there is always, so there is a challenge with informed consent. That is the way to situate it, in terms of when people collect data for one particular reason, but then they use it for other reason that was not communicated to the data owners at the time those details were being given.
Government will come on here, link your line, otherwise you will be blocked. They won't even tell you reason why you should link your line. They won't even go further to tell you that if you do this, this will happen. But because we are scared, because we love ourselves, we don't want any trouble, we'll go ahead and in the end, after the precaution.
How do we begin to rectify the issue of citizens' lack of trust for government, especially where the data is concerned?
Well, my advice is that federal government must do enough to educate Nigerians and also to regulate who and who should have access to this information.
The best way to build trust is to involve the person on whose behalf you're making those decisions, right? So if I know you're taking a decision on my behalf, you know, it's easier for me to feel at ease or, you know, even more relaxed about the decisions that you're making. So we need to ensure that the Nigerian government, you know, carry citizens along on how this, you know, processes are being done.
So the government should put structures in place to ensure proper data protection. As a matter of fact, I will be confident to give out my information if I am sure there are structures in place that will protect data.
The other is also communicating, you know, policy actions or decisions, you know, I mean, to citizens. Why do we need to take your NIN? Right? Why do we need to take your BVN? Why do we need, you know, to, for instance, connect them to each other? Where are we? Status update is also necessary. This is how far we've gone. This is where we're going. This is the threat if we don't collect. This is the threat we're trying to, you know, curb that's making us collect. Such information, such level of communication is necessary for citizens to begin to build trust, you know, in government.
And one of the recommendations that I'd written down is, you know, we have a Nigerian data protection regulation, which needs to be gazetted just so that people even know, you know, when he was talking about the education bit, he said so people know what they should submit. But it also should tell people what that data will be used for and what it won't be used for.
And also ensuring that, you know, the, what do we call it now? The third sector is also carried along, and I mean the media, the civil society organizations are also carried along, which many times are like, you know, citizens' mouthpiece and the ones that help citizens to understand at the grassroots level government policies and implications for them. So you want to ensure that you carry them along and not turn them to your opponent or your antagonist in. And government needs to really, really review some of its existing or, you know, current decisions about, you know, DTS. I mean, we just had some days back that the National Assembly approved, you know, the procurement of surveillance systems to monitor our WhatsApp and also to Raya communication in the country. That does not put forward any element of trust from citizens from government, you know. So such act, you know, needs to be reviewed. You know, the Twitter ban also needs to be reviewed, because that already tells us that if you had the power and you used the power to tell the telecommunication companies, you know, to block a certain level of information, it already tells us that every other kind of information or communication that we are having, you can also, you know, infringe on them, or, you know, I mean, every level of impunity can be applied to that. So some of these existing actions of government needs to be reviewed and needs to better be explained to citizens, even if they are needed at all.
In carrying out this study, the following were uncovered. Citizens are not aware of the procurement and use of DTSs as well as the procurement process. Although the government MDAs follow the procurement process as stated in the Public Procurement Act, PPA 2007, when procuring DTSs, there are no specific laws that relate to DTSs procurement. The government is not completely open in its budgeting and procurement of DTSs. There are existing laws and policies that relate to the use of DTSs. However, these laws are not comprehensive. The Ministry of Defense is currently developing a Defense Procurement Act for DTSs. And findings indicate that the government's directive of linking NINs with every other identity database is an attempt to unify all identification information into a central database.
The use of digital technology systems in Nigeria affects every citizen, as taxpayers' monies are used to procure these tools, some of which run into billions of naira. So data generated using these tools belong to Nigerians, and if they are used for other causes outside the benefits of Nigerians, it is highly unacceptable. So yeah, a few recommendations on how the issue of misuse and lack of trust can be curbed.
The government should ensure more openness in digital technology systems, budgeting and procurement. The government and CSOs should create awareness to inform the public about the need and benefits of digital technology systems investments, as well as the existing laws to help citizens be aware of their rights to privacy. With the development of the Defense Procurement Act for digital technology systems, the government can be better prepared, especially in situations like the pandemic. The existing laws that relate to the use of digital technology systems need to be amended to speak to the generality of data privacy and protection, and to ensure that the procurement and use of DTS do not infringe on the rights of citizens, thereby ensuring adequate protection of citizens' privacy and personal data.
Until governments and private sector organizations assume greater responsibility for digital rights, the status quo will remain. All hands need to be on deck to ensure all citizens' rights are protected.